Ablation, pitfalls, and potential solutions. So these are the slides under which are the subheadings on which I'm going to speak about. So one of the first question comes is, what is atrial fibrillation? As we can see in this, there is regular contraction and also uniform contraction of the different chambers of the heart, and the electrical impulses tend to originate in a specialized tissue over here, which is called as the sinoatrial node, and followed by regular normal contractions of the different chambers, and the electrical impulses tend to go to the other areas of the heart. However, in this specialized condition, which is called as atrial fibrillation, there's irregular contractions of the chambers of the heart of the atrium, which is also followed by the ventricular irregular contractions. On a closer look, we can also see the contractions are not so good, and the heart rate is also pretty fast. And further, when we try to see for the electrical impulses, they tend to originate in the wall of the atrium, which tends to get and conduct and also make the wall fibrillate as well. So after this, one of the second question comes is, why atrial fibrillation? It is not just only the most common heart arrhythmia, but also a significant leading cause of morbidity and also mortality as well. In fact, with increasing age expectancy of people in the developing and developed countries, its incidence is also increasing. And when we think about its success rate, it's a big question. As in this slide, we can see the long-term success rate, especially for the benign type, is almost around 54%. However, for a little bit complex type, which is called as the non-paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, is hardly around 42%. I think we all will agree over here that prevention is always better than cure. So if we can take care of the preventable causes, definitely we can decrease the atrial fibrillation burden by taking control of the hypertension, obesity, or the alcohol toxicity, and the pulmonary infection, and also the antiarrhythmic drugs. So now, coming to the therapy, what are the possible ways in which it can be treated? Since 1998, the way in which we try to target has definitely changed, and now we tend to target mostly is the pulmonary veins, as they tend to house most of the common pulmonary vein triggers as well. There is different approach, the way in which a cardiologist approach by going on the inside surface of the heart, and the surgeon which tends to go on the outer surface of the heart, which is called as the epicardial approach. However, both of the approaches tend to have the advantages and some disadvantages as well. Advantage of the cardiologist approach being good electrophysiological endpoints. However, the disadvantages associated with the epicardial approach being limited lesion sets and also to test those lesions. So there is another approach as well which tends to combine the advantages of both approach and do away with their disadvantages. There are various energy sources which are available for ablation, the most common being radio frequency, through which it tends to burn the tissue, and cryo, which tends to do the freezing. There are different energy sources also which is available in the form of balloon-based or also single-shot devices. So during any therapy which is given, there can be potential problems and also some solutions. Let's look at the problems which we came across. If a patient comes out with complaints of coughing out of blood, so one of the common causes which we have to think is narrowing of the pulmonary vein. So some of the common causes which can be associated with this is either excessive use of power, or there's lack of virtual imaging, or lack of experience. This was one such patient who had presented again with complaints of atrial fibrillation, and while trying to see for the pelvic vein surgically, on the epicardial surface we could see there was fibrosis of the lung veins over here, as pointed out by the arrow. This was another such patient which was having again recurrence of atrial fibrillation, and when we tried to do a CT, over here we could see narrowing of the left inferior pulmonary vein. And while trying to attempt the surgical ablation of these pulmonary veins, we could not only notice adhesions, but also fibrosis of the pulmonary veins, which ultimately led to pulmonary vein stenosis. This is another such patient who had presented with complaints of localized chest pain. It was a few weeks after the surgical ablation, and in this we could see protrusion of the lung tissue into the chest cavity. This is another three-dimensional reconstruction of the same patient. If again the patient comes with similar complaints, what are the other reasons which we need to see? It has been described that after cryo balloon ablation, some of the patients can develop pulmonary hemorrhages. But is it really a rare entity? We don't think so. So while trying to do a literature review, we saw one of the first mentions way back in 1974 with experimental studies. And later on, even during experimental studies with animals, it was described in 2004. And of course, after that, there has been multiple studies clinically which proved or showed the same side effect. During one of our such patients on the CT, we could also notify was about the ground glass opacification of the pulmonary veins. This is a group of around 6 patients who had developed such complication out of a group of around 300 patients. As you can see in the slide, most of such patients had developed this complication just within a few days of the procedure. On trying to do this detailed statistical analysis of such patients, we saw in the inferior pulmonary veins, there is a significant lower temperature of the cryoballoon ablation. As every coin has two sides, similarly, not only problems are there, but there are also potential solutions as well during the atrial fibrillation ablation. So, now coming to the potential solutions. Atrial fibrillation and chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, which is a common breathing difficulty disease, can make the treatment really complicated. And they are very much associated with very high incidence of stroke and also major adverse side effects as well, including mortality. So we had a group of around 7 patients having very bad lung function, a pretty high obesity index, and a long duration of the atrial fibrillation. And then for such patients, initially the cardiac surgeon goes and makes the epicardial ablation lesions, and the right-sided lung veins were ablated using the epicardial bipolar clamps, and the left-sided were ablated using the cryoballoon. And at the end of 3 years, we could see for such patients that 6 of them are right now in science fair. One of the other common energy sources which is pretty commonly used is catheter-based radio frequency. This has already undergone generations of change with the introduction of multi-port cool-tip irrigation for this actually. And one of the recent additions for this is the use of contact force. Why contact force? Because it has been shown the contact between the ablation tissue and also the tissue as well can affect by, if the contact force is quite a lot, there can be steam pore formation, and if further if it is really high, it can also lead to contact cardiac perforation as well. So we tried to use this catheter for the hyperablation, and we saw we could avoid the energy source application in the areas where the contact was not good, and also the quality of the lesion became better. It reduced our ablation time. So on an overall basis, the procedure became much more safer. We all have a tendency to look into the future, what else can we do? So we also try to see, is it possible to predict the outcome of atrial fibrillation ablation by looking, if possible, at the P wave? So we all know that there are different segments of the atria which can contribute to the P wave. For example, the myocardial sinus tend to contribute to its middle portion, and the late portion is determined by the late activation of the atria. So we especially look at this echocardiographic parameter. But one of the problems was, of course, angle dependent, and we were really not so happy with this. So what we did was we came across, we had to introduce our mathematical equation, which seems to see the period duration in a very accurate way. And we tried to use it for the hybrid ablation, pre-procedure and after procedure. So what is the duration changes which is happening? And we saw all the patients had a significant decrease. Further, for the persistent atrial fibrillation, which is the most complex type, there was a much more significant decrease. And in this slide, we can see there is a good and significant role of the use of antiarrhythmic drugs as well. And this slide further states the need for electrical cardioversions as well. And for the atrial fibrillation recurrence, if there is a significant decrease in the period duration, it can definitely tend to predict the atrial fibrillation recurrence as well. Adenosine is a very simple and common drug which is available in most of the EP labs, and it is considered superior to isoproterenol to reveal the dominant reconduction. This is the protocol which we followed after doing the ablation. We had a waiting time of 30 minutes, and data product laser catheter was put up to see for the pulmonary vein potentials. The drug was given, and we tried to see if we can see those dormant conduction. The ablation was done for such areas, and if it was there, after ablation, repeat adenosine was again done. So this is how we see these sharp potentials, which is called as dormant conduction, but only for a few weeks. So we tested this technique after the surgical ablation, and we saw that it can be seen only 1%. It seems a little bit difficult to imagine, but what is the possible reason? The possible reasons are two. Yes, first thing is good continuous lesions and also good transmural lesions. We applied the same concept for the testing of second generation cryoballoon ablation as well, and we saw the patients under which dormant conduction was ablated, they tend to have a higher ablation success. Further, when we tried to use the same technique for the balloon-based energy sources, we also saw that there is a similar success rate of around 85%. So the studies which we did, we also tend to get support from the other studies as well, which recently came into publication. To summarize, we all have come a long way in the journey of atrial fibrillation and ablation, but still we all have a long way to go. And to summarize, honorable members of the corona, friends, family and colleagues, the pitfalls which are seen during atrial fibrillation ablation are definitely preventable. Patients of atrial fibrillation with COPD can expect better outcomes with hybrid AF ablation, and success rate may increase with the use of adenosine. Further, by noticing the period duration, we can also determine the success rate of the hybrid procedure, and the use of contact force catheters during hybrid ablation is symbiotic. Thank you so much for your kind attention.
Thank you very much. Your position will now be opened by Professor Gorgels. Professor Gorgels is Professor of Transmural Cardiology in Maastricht University and Chairman of the EU Committee.
Dear candidate, I'd like to discuss with you some facts which you wrote up in Chapter 10 on the adenosine testing, which improves the clinical success rate for atrial fibrillation. And my first question is, you have two populations. One with non-adenosine, the other with adenosine. Is this a randomized? It's not clear from the paper whether this is a randomized study as a whole. If not, how you actually derive those populations?
Highly esteemed member of competent team, thank you so much for the question. It's a very good question, actually. We had around 90 patients totally, and in the 90 patients was divided equally into 45 patients who will undergo adenosine testing and who will not undergo. It was not a prospective study, it was a retrospective study, and we tried to combine the population and we tried to do and see, of course, with respect to the follow for this.
So it was a retrospective study designed with two populations actually gathered and compared. Okay, thank you. My next question is about figure 10.1 in page 123.
Yes.
It's a Kaplan-Meier curve.
Yep.
And it shows actually two lines, and this is a follow-up of about 400 days.
Yep.
And when you compare the see that the recurrence rate is actually quite high. It's 40%. And I think this is in contrast to this which you show in the table of 126. Here we see a follow-up of 379 plus or minus 47. So apparently the follow-up is much longer because there is a quite standard deviation. And here you find, although the recurrence rate the follow-up is wrong, you find lower recurrence rates. I cannot understand it. Maybe you can explain.
Yeah, hi, esteemed opponent. Thank you so much for the question. It's a very valid question, and I can understand your concerns very well. So what we tried to discuss was at an annual year follow-up, and that's what we initially followed, and you are very right that the data which was there, of course, tends to take care even for the 400 days as well, and for some of them. And we tried to statistically correct it and look at an annual year follow-up, and that's what is the figure which is mentioned in the diagram over here. In the figure 10.2. So we mentioned at the end of around 1 year, so how much did we see the success rate with the follow-up of such patients?
But how do you explain then the differences in outcomes?
Yes, possibly with longer outcome follow-up as well, the success rate tends to decrease possibly. But we need to further look into much more data as well. And it will be, of course, nice to see on a much more prospective, randomized, and even more centers involving. The data will have a much more clearer way for outcome.
But do I have to believe that the recurrence rate is 40% or only 60%?
The recurrence rate, what we are talking about,
after 400 days.
After 400 days, I think we'll have to go with the Kaplan-Meier curve, which is shown so far. Yes.
And then the last question about methodology and results. You point out in page 124 that there is no statistically significant difference using the rock rank test of equality.
Yes.
And then you continue in the discussion section that the success rate was significantly higher.
Yes.
How do I?
Yes, and so this was also one of the, thank you so much, it's a really nice fact actually. So what had happened is when we tried to initially see in this study was around 45 patients versus 45 patients. And it was also one of the questions which was raised by the reviewer. But later on what had happened when we tried to see statistically for some more patients as well, like more than 50-55, because this study was done with the adenosine dormant reproduction, we did it for more than 50 patients in fact. So when we try to have the whole thing together, then it was statistically significant.
That's not in the paper.
But yes, but in the 45 patients, what we saw was 0.06, which we have written in the paper.
Yeah, that's true. So that's a borderline.
Yes, and that's why I had to use the word maybe. It is
significantly higher than that.
And that's one of the references as well, which I showed in the Lancet, which has came as a prospective, multi-center, randomized study as well, which showed that there is a benefit if we tend to review the dormant reduction using the adenosine.
And when I made another point is, when you look to the Kaplan-Meier curves in page 123, you see that the recurrence start to occur quite late, huh?
Yeah.
Especially in the adenosine group. What do you think that means mechanistically? Is this due to failure of the procedure, or is it due to something else?
It could be possibly related to the type of patients as well which we enrolled, but because in this study what we enrolled was most of them were paroxysmal patients. And only very few of them were persistent atrial fibrillation. So possibly it could be related to the type of patient selection as well, which was there, and also the echocardiographic parameters as well, because echocardiographic parameters, especially like left atrial volume, can play a very significant role to predict their long-term, or not even long-term, even short-term recurrence rates as well.
Yeah. So it could be related to the progression of disease, actually.
Yes.
And that's a concern because you do quite a basic procedure, and then you see that after some time, you recurrently, maybe because of progression of disease.
Yes.
Is that something which you would like to advise patients, maybe to prevent progression of disease? Is that something which you have in your daily practice when seeing those patients after after the procedure?
Thank you. This is a very important thing. That's why in my initial slide as well, I tried to show prevention is always better. So definitely, before going for the therapy as well, doing ablations and all, it's pretty fine. But we should always try to take care of those preventable causes which are there. And definitely, the issue of thyroid disorders, even hypertension.
Which is hypertension.
Yes, hypertension, then even pulmonary diseases as well. And in fact, infections itself, or the use of some of the antiarrhythmic drugs as well. So we all need to be really careful. Even there are some non-preventable risk factors as well, something like age and all. We have to expect the sex difference as well.
Yeah, but we also know that lifestyle change, changing of lifestyle could be very important. Obesity, swimming, sports, better foods, etc. may prevent also recurrences of hypertension. Is that something which you advise already to your patients? And do they receive upstream therapy? Do they get lifestyle advices?
Yes.
Is that something which is the practice now after?
Thank you so much for pointing out this point. This indeed, therapeutic lifestyle is one of the most important things which we should always advise to our patients, rather than just advising or practicing or administrating them or loading them literally with medicine and ablation interventional procedures as well. So therapeutic lifestyle, which you rightly said it, like exercise and these factors, these are indeed the most important factors. And that's why I started my slides with the preventable causes for age of
hypertension. Thank you very much for the discussion, and I give the word back to the program.
Opposition will be continued by Professor Smeets. Professor Smeets is professor of cardiology at Radboud University in Nijmegen and is a member of the committee.
Thank you very much. I want to start, first of all, to congratulate you, Mr. Candidate, and also your promoter and co-promotores for the achievement of this thesis. Since it's a proof of scientific thinking, I want to challenge you a little bit, and I want to start with a statement. Do you agree when I say the shorter the procedure time in AF, in this case, the less complications you have? And you have two possibilities. Either it's a yes or a no. It's easy.
Highly esteemed opponent, Professor Smeets. Definitely yes.
Yeah. Now we go to chapter 10 on page 124. Then it gives me a puzzle because I see there the procedure timings you have are respectively 174 minutes and 212 minutes. This is pretty long. And what I find counterintuitive is that if you do additional procedures like adenosine, the procedure gets shorter than when you do not do it. So could you give some comments about the duration of the procedure and why is the procedure given adenosine shorter than the procedure not given?
Thank you so much for pointing such a very valid and very important question. There are several studies by Sigonti Group, which was published way back in 2011, and there was also some publications from the Josephson group as well. When they tried to see first the time after the adenosine administration, they tried to see the dormitory conduction after 20 minutes, after 30 minutes, even 40 minutes, and even 60 minutes as well. And they could see that after 30 minutes, this is said to be one of the most optimal outcomes. And in fact, as you rightly said, if we tend to prolong the procedure duration, patient can develop some complications. However, we need to see the overall good for the patients. For example,
I understand the more testing you do, the longer the procedure gets, but looking to your numbers, the adenosine group is shorter, even if you have to wait longer than in the group in comparison, if you don't get adenosine. Can you give me a clue why that is?
If I could understand your question, you said it was shorter in the adenosine group.
Yeah.
So probably there can be some operator bias as well, with which is associated with the learning curve of the operators as well, and also a lot of different other factors as well, which could be playing, like monitoring of the patient during the procedure as well. But this is what is my opinion.
Well, I saw that in your previous chapter, in the initial chapter about the adenosine testing, you also mentioned that there is probably a learning curve.
Yes.
But if I look to the numbers in that chapter versus chapter 10, the numbers are equally the same. So there is, for me, not clearly a learning curve. So in other words, how could you shorten the procedure in order to prevent a complication ratio occurrence?
So possibly, if I could understand the question, the operators needs to be a little bit more experienced, and of course there should be good flow of the different steps during the ablation procedure as well, which can definitely have a much more positive and better outcome, decreasing the ablation procedure timing as well. And also one needs to be taking care of how long are we doing the ablation, and as I showed it as well, for example, different energy sources itself. For example, when we try to use the first generation cryo-balloon ablation, the ablation time used to be around 5 minutes. And for example, with the second generation, it has already decreased to around 4 minutes. And sometimes there is lesser use of the freezing or the bonus timing as well.
So, but is that your current practice, that instead of giving several applications of cryo-energy, two at one site, you decrease that now to one, like suggested in the literature?
Some of the recent studies are there from Siconte group from Brussels, and also from Maessen group from Hamburg, which they have shown that there might not be any use of giving additional bonus applications for the cryoablation, and they tend to have a similar outcome without freezing as well.
So that's a very practical approach for making the time the procedure shorter in time.
Yeah.
Okay, second question, you puzzle me a little bit if you say that what size of balloon we are going to use. And you have two choices, it's 28 millimeter balloon and 23 millimeter balloon. And then the puzzling effect for me starts when most groups start with a large balloon, the 28, because, well, the larger the surfaces you destroy of the atrium, the less atrium there is which can fibrillate, which is, I think, quite an obvious reasoning. And then you say, well, the occlusion is different because the larger balloon gives a less occlusion than a 23 millimeter balloon, which is correct. And then you said also that in the 23 millimeter balloon, you're deeper in the pulmonary vein. And the deeper you are in the pulmonary vein, the more complications you get, like bleeding or stenosis. Mm-hmm. So you still think that your advice, what you gave in this chapter, to go with a small balloon holds true?
Thank you so much for this really interesting question as well. What tends to happen is we not only just have to see the diameter of the pulmonary veins, but also the complications which may happen. So of course, with a bigger cryo balloon, it has been shown there is lesser the number of complications. And as you rightly pointed out as well, if the cryo balloon which is used is a bit smaller, there is a tendency, of course, for the cryo balloon to slip inside, and which can lead to further complications and other problems as well. Mm-hmm. So their safety profile tends to be much more better with a bigger cryo balloon. However, with a smaller cryo balloon, it can be easy to manipulate or the maneuver. But of course, on an overall basis, you need to see everything. What are the outcomes which is expected? And of course, the most important priority is the safety profile of the patient as well.
One short remark, and then I give the word back, is that when I'm looking at your statements, there are several statements where the Prime Minister of India, or the former Prime Minister of India, is mentioned, and you end up with Winston Churchill. I think you should be a very ambitious person to put those statements here. And I want to end only with a statement of Winston Churchill, and he says, "Every one has his day. And some days last longer than others." I wish you a very good day.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
The position will be continued by Dr. Dual. Dr. Dual is a cardiologist in the University Medical Center in Colonia and was a member of the DDB committee.
Dear Kendra, dear Madonna, congratulations on this achievement today.
It's a pleasure for me to be here because a couple of years ago we worked together and I saw your initial steps in the EP lab. I want to ask you today about the hybrid procedures. You have been actively involved in this procedure and four of the chapters are also about this procedure. And as you may know, we have also started this procedure in Groningen. And I think it's a big step forward because we can now treat some patients who may not benefit from the percutaneous approach. But I still have some difficulties with the procedure, and it has to do with the patient selection and the procedural details. So what should we do during the procedure? So I actually have two questions and I want to start with the first one. So what would you, in the outpatient clinic, what would you what kind of information would you need to decide what kind of procedure would you do for the patient? So who may benefit from a percutaneous approach, the hybrid ablation, or maybe no ablation at all? And so what was your approach, what would you do?
Esteemed opponent Dr. Block, thank you so much for this question. This is indeed really important question, not only from the side of the patient, but also from the us people who are delivering the healthcare to such patients as well. So I think you may also agree, one of the first most important cause which we should consider is the type of atrial fibrillation itself, what you are having, is it a paroxysmal? And for the paroxysmal patients, if the AF duration is not really long, I think this should be preferred for the percutaneous approach, and at the same time, we should also try to take care for the left atrial volume as well, and if they have already been given antiarrhythmic drugs. However, if some patients are there who have already undergone the cryoballoon ablation or the radiofrequency ablation, in fact earlier, left atrial volume has been pretty big, in fact, and they are still not responding to the antiarrhythmic drugs, and we can of course, we should explain them the different pros and cons which can be associated with the hybrid approach as well. And I think such candidates are definitely one of the optimal candidates for such procedure.
So it's a pure clinical perspective you now have, obviously. Would you also consider imaging? There's a lot of debate about the visualization of the substrate. So what kind of tools would you use for that?
It's a nice point as well, especially the use of imaging. One of the important tools which we all, I think, likely as well, the use of either 3D electroanatomical mapping, the use of traditional ones being, of course, the CARTO itself. And I also came across that, for example, the lesion lines can also, it should be actually decided, especially when those lines are being distributed on the basis of the voltage map as well. And the newer imaging modalities, of course, to visualize the scar, especially with the use of